Welcome to our virtual celebration of music, poetry, and prose from Bradenham Church grounds. Once lockdown measures were put in place, we knew that our celebration wouldn't be able to go ahead in its conventional format. I got in touch with Mr. Rogers and Mr. Langridge and said, "Is there any chance we could do a concert and put it on our YouTube channel?" At John Hampden, as you know, the show will go on, and so I am indebted to Mr. Langridge, Mr. Rogers, to the staff and the students that have taken part, shared their music, shared their poems and their readings, and enabled us to put this concert on for you to enjoy. Please feel free to share it with your family and your friends. And I'll hand over now to Mr. Langridge.
Welcome to the 2020 virtual Bradenham Concert of Music and Literature. I'm not sure if you noticed, but on the way in, the village has put a flag up to celebrate the NHS, and I think at the moment the NHS is in all our thoughts. At the same time that the Black Death was ravaging Europe, across the other side of the world, countries were having to deal with famine and invasion. And among them was Persia, and a young Persian poet called Hafiz looked up into the sky and wrote this poem.
Even after all this time, the sun never says to the earth, "You owe me." Look what happens with a love like that. It lights the whole sky.
Unfortunately, pestilence and disease has always been with us, and one of the biggest outbreaks was in 1665. Samuel Pepys, the diarist, was recording the event. And here we have some extracts from his diary, read by Conrad Barrett.
Samuel Pepys and the Great Plague of London. In August, Pepys dispatched his wife and her household to the countryside, locking up their spacious house in the city. They were very afraid of catching the plague that was spreading across London and could cause death in a matter of hours. Spread by contaminated fleas biting humans, Londoners still had no idea how the disease was caused. Yet Pepys himself continued to travel often into London and to take extraordinary risks, such as visiting the huge plague burial pits in Moorfields, where he observed, "Never so sorrowful a sight have I seen as the bodies lying there." He was often afraid. In one entry he recorded, "I was in great trouble all this day for my boy Tom, who went to Greenwich yesterday by my order and came not home till tonight for fear of the plague. But he did come tonight and is safe." Among quack remedies, he chewed tobacco and tried out a bottle of plague water, probably made with herbs, though he does not record whether he drank it. On September 6th, he watched fires burning in the street, as it is by the Lord's Mayor order. The city had appointed government scientists like today's scientists, only then their advice was to cover the city with wood smoke. It is not surprising that the Lord Mayor was desperate. In the last week of August, more than 6,000 deaths were attributed to plague, and Pepys remarked that this was probably an underestimate, partly from the poor that cannot be taken notice of through the greatness of the number. "It troubled me to pass by Cheapside, where about 21 people have died of the plague, and a watch is constantly kept there, night and days, to keep the people in. Here was an early brutal lockdown, the plague making us cruel as dogs one to another. Yet amid this great catalogue of woe, which persisted until the year's end, part of the fascination of Pepys' diary is that he tried to remain cheerful by continuing to visit pubs, eat out with friends, and chase any woman who came near. He was lucky. In September, he wrote, I do end this month with the greatest content, having nothing but the consideration of the sickliness of the season to mortify me, for all which the Lord God be praised. At least 70,000 Londoners had died, about one in six of the capital's inhabitants. Yet by New Year's Eve, the plague was passing, and Pepys celebrated with his wife back in his house in Seething Lane, and to our great joy, the town fills apace, and shops begin to be open again.
This is the Dance of the Sugar Plum Fairy from the ballet The Nutcracker by Tchaikovsky.
Most of you know the writer Roald Dahl, who lived quite close to us here in Great Lissenden. Now, Dr. Estridge is going to give her own inimitable take on Little Red Riding Hood.
As soon as Wolf began to feel that he would like a decent meal, he went and knocked on Grandma's door. When Grandma opened it, she saw the sharp white teeth, the horrid grin, and Wolfie said, "May I come in?" Poor Grandmama was terrified. "He's going to eat me up," she cried. And she was absolutely right. He ate her up in one big bite. But Grandmama was small and tough, and Wolfie wailed, "It's not enough. I haven't yet begun to feel that I have had a decent meal." And he ran around the kitchen yelping, "I've got to have a second helping." And then added with a frightful leer, "I'm therefore going to wait right here till Little Miss Red Riding Hood comes home from walking in the wood." He quickly put on Grandma's clothes. Of course, he hadn't eaten those. He dressed himself in coat and hat. He put on shoes. And after that, he even brushed and curled his hair, then sat himself in Grandma's chair. In came the little girl in red. She stopped. She stared. And then she said, "What great big ears you have, Grandma." "All the better to hear you with," the wolf replied. "What great big eyes you have, Grandma," said Little Red Riding Hood. "All the better to see you with," the wolf replied. He sat there watching her and smiled. He thought, "I'm going to eat this child. Compared with her old Grandmama, she's going to taste like caviar." Then Little Red Riding Hood said, "But Grandma, what a lovely, great, big, furry coat you have on." "That's wrong," cried the wolf. "Have you forgot to tell me what big teeth I've got?" "Ah, well, no matter what you say, I'm going to eat you anyway." The small girl smiles. One eyelid flickers. She whips a pistol from her knickers and aims it at the creature's head, and bang, 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 she shoots him dead. A few weeks later, in the wood, I came across Miss Riding Hood. Oh, but what a change! No cloak of red, no silly hood upon her head. She said, hello, and do please note my lovely, furry, wolfskin coat.
For many people, the image of the rainbow is a symbol of hope at this time. Here, Dylan Solanke reads the words of the popular song, Somewhere Over the Rainbow.
Somewhere over the rainbow, way up high, there's a land that I heard of once in a lullaby. Somewhere over the rainbow, skies are blue, and the dreams that you dare to dream really do come true. Someday, I'll wish upon a star and wake up where the clouds are far behind me, where troubles melt like lemon drops away above the chimney tops. That's where you'll find me. Somewhere over the rainbow, bluebirds fly. Birds fly over the rainbow. Why then? Oh, why can't I? If happy little bluebirds fly beyond the rainbow, why? Oh, why can't I?
Thank you.
In 1987, a man called Terry Waite, who was a hostage negotiator, was himself taken hostage. He endured 7 years in captivity, of which 4 were spent in isolation and in the dark. Here are his words about the coronavirus, read by Flo Bischoff.
Surviving this new reality of the coronavirus is hard. It'll be hard for a while. Many people are worried. Worried about the future, about their families, about their jobs. When I was captain in Beirut all those years ago, I was worried. Worried about my family. Worried about myself. Worried whether I would survive. I had no books, no papers, nothing except darkness. So I began to write in my head, to extend my mental capabilities, to try to remember words of songs of people I'd met or meals I'd had, just to get through the day. I had to hold on to the fact that I had life now, at that moment, not tomorrow. So that is why I say to people during this time, it is hard, but try to develop the capacity within yourself to live fully in the moment. Develop the capacity to say there's little I can do to change or alter this. You have to get through it. Create a structure to the day. Challenge yourself. Be kinder. Make each moment as full as possible. The virus will eventually be defeated, and we will get through. Perhaps it could even be a much needed reminder that we depend on one another and on the environment that sustains us.
And now Miss Summers will sing Smile.
Smile though your heart is aching. Smile even though it's breaking. When there are clouds in the sky, you'll get by. If you smile through your fear and sorrow, smile and maybe tomorrow you'll see the sun come shining through for you. Light up your face with gladness, hide every trace of sadness, although a tear may be ever so near. That's the time you must keep on trying. Smile, what's the use of crying? You'll find that life is still worthwhile if you just smile. That's the time you must keep on trying. Smile, what's the use of crying? You'll find that life is still worthwhile if you
G. Woodhouse wrote many stories about Jeeves and Worcester and the upper classes. Behind me is Bradenham Manor, and Mr. Till is going to read a story called Blandings about a lord of the manor.
The morning sunshine descended like an amber shower bath on Blandings Castle, lighting up with a heartening glow its ivied walls, its rolling parks, its gardens and outhouses, and such of its inhabitants as chanced at the moment to be taking the air. It fell on the 9th Earl of Emsworth, and on Beach, his faithful butler. They were standing on the turret above the west wing, the former with his eye to a powerful telescope, the latter holding the hat which he'd been sent to fetch. "The Beach," said Lord Emsworth. "My lord, I've been swindled. This dash thing doesn't work." "Your lordship cannot see clearly." "Can't see at all, dash it. It's all black." The butler was an observant man. "Perhaps if I were to remove the cap at the extremity of the instrument, my lord, more satisfactory results might be obtained." "Eh? Cap? Is there a cap?" "So there is. Take it off, Beach." "Very good, my lord." "Ah, yes, that's better. That's capital. Beach, I can see a cow." "Indeed, my lord." The 9th Earl of Emsworth was a fluffy-minded and amiable old gentleman with a fondness for new toys. Although the main interest of his life was his garden, he was always ready to try a sideline, and the latest of these sidelines was this telescope. Ordered from London in a burst of enthusiasm, consequent upon the reading of an article on astronomy in a monthly magazine, it had been placed in position on the previous evening. What was now in progress was its trial trip. Presently, the cow's audience appeal began to wane. It was a fine cow, as cows go, but like so many cows, it lacked sustained dramatic interest. Surfeited after a while by the spectacle of it chewing the cud and staring glassily at nothing, Lord Emsworth decided to swivel the instrument round in the hope of picking up something a trifle more sensational. And he was just about to do so, when into the range of his vision there came the Honourable Freddy. White and shining, he tripped along over the turf like a Theocritan shepherd, hastening to keep an appointment with a nymph. And a sudden frown marred the serenity of Lord Emsworth's brow. He generally frowned when he saw Freddy, for with the passage of the years, that youth had become more and more of a problem to an anxious father. Unlike the male codfish, which, suddenly finding itself the parent of 3,500,000 little codfish, cheerfully resolves to love them all, the British aristocracy is apt to look with a somewhat jaundiced eye on its younger sons.
In 1942, at the height of World War II, when it seemed that Britain might lose the war, the poet T.S. Eliot visited a garden in the village of Little Gidding. Here is part of the poem, read by Tom Hardy.
An extract from Little Gidding, the last of T.S. Eliot's four quartets. We shall not cease from exploration, and the end of all our exploring will be to arrive where we started and know the place for the very first time. Through the unknown, unremembered gate, when the last of earth to discover is that which is the beginning, at the source of the longest river, the voice of the hidden waterfall, and the children in the apple tree, not known because not looked for, but heard, half heard, in the stillness between two waves of the sea, quick, now, here, now, always, a condition of complete simplicity, costing not less than everything, and all shall be well, and all manner of things shall be well, when the tongues of flame are enfolded into the crowned knot of fire, and the fire and rose are one.
During William Shakespeare's time, there were 5 different outbreaks of plague in both Stratford-on-Avon and in London, but miraculously he survived. In 1606, during a time of such plague, he kept to his house in a type of lockdown and wrote 3 plays. One of them was King Lear, which many think is perhaps the best play ever written. Charlie Bass will now read the last few lines of the play.
The last lines from the play, King Lear, spoken by Edgar. The weight of this sad time we must obey. Speak what we feel, not what we ought to say. The oldest hath borne most, we that are young shall never see so much.
Many people have taken the opportunity of the lockdown to pursue hobbies like writing. A young gentleman called Tom Roberts had a poem he wrote on ITV's This Morning show. It's called The Great Realization, and many people have found it inspiring. Here it's read by James Lewis.
The Great Realization by Tom Roberts. Tell me the one about the virus again, then I'll go to bed. But boy, you're growing weary, soupy thoughts about your head. Please, that one's my favourite. I promise, just once more. Okay, snuggle down, my boy. Though I know you know full well, the story starts before then, in a world I once would dwell. We'd always had our wants, but now it got so quick. You could have everything you dreamed of, in a day and with a click. We noticed families had stopped talking. That's not to say they never spoke, but the meaning must have melted and the work-life balance broke. And the children's eyes got squarer and every toddler had a phone. They filtered out the imperfections, but amidst the noise, they were alone. And every day the sky grew thicker till we couldn't see the stars. So we flew in planes to find them, while down below we filled our cars. We'd drive around all day in circles, we'd forgotten how to run. We swapped the grass for tarmac, shrunk the parks till there were none. We filled the sea with plastic, because our waste was never capped. Each day when you went fishing, you'd pull them out, already wrapped. But then in 2020, a new virus came our way. The government reacted and told us all to hide away. But while we were all hidden, amidst the fear and all the while, the people dusted off their instincts, they remembered how to smile. They started clapping to say thank you and calling up their mums. And while car keys were gathering dust, they would look forward to their runs. And with the sky less full of planes, the earth began to breathe. And beaches brought new wildlife that scattered off into the seas. Some people started dancing, some were singing, some were baking. We'd grown so used to bad news that some good news was in the making. And so when we found the cure and we were allowed to go outside, we all preferred the world we found to the one we'd left behind. Old habits became extinct and they made way for the new. And every simple act of kindness was now given its due. But why did it take a virus to bring the people back together? Well, sometimes you've got to get sick, my boy, before you start getting better. Now lie down and dream of tomorrow and all the things that we can do. And who knows, maybe if you dream hard enough, maybe some of them will come true. We now call it the Great Realization, and yet, since then, there have been many. But that's the story of how it started, and why hindsight's 2020.
There has been much in recent weeks to make us sad, anxious, and worried. Much to make us feel despondent and fed up. But there have also been so many examples of kindness which give us hope, acts of generosity which give us strength, and occasions of humour which lighten our mood. A poem that I've enjoyed and related to since the first time I ever heard it is The Road Not Taken by Robert Frost. I was introduced to this poem when I was a student at school in Canada, and have come back to it time and time again over the years. And now I think the words are just as relevant. It closes with, "Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference." The Road Not Taken by Robert Frost. Two roads diverged in a yellow wood, and sorry I could not travel both, and be one traveller. Long I stood and looked down one as far as I could to where it bent in the undergrowth. And then took the other as just as fair and having perhaps the better claim because it was grassy and wanted wear. Though as for that, the passing there had worn them really about the same. And both that morning equally lay in leaves no step had trodden black. Oh, I kept the first for another day. Yet knowing how way leads on to way, I doubted if I should ever come back. I shall be telling this with a sigh somewhere ages and ages hence. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less travelled by, and that has made all the difference. We'll be facing many choices ahead as we come out of this lockdown, and we are being given a unique chance to do some things differently going forward. Perhaps it is time to choose the road less travelled by. I hope that our concert has moved you, inspired you, and above all, raised your spirits. I miss not seeing all of you in the Cricket Club Pavilion, and so I'll raise a glass. Cheers. Look forward to seeing you soon. Take care. Stay safe.
That's the end of our virtual Bradenham Concert for 2020, and it just remains for me to say a big thank you to everyone who took part, and here's hoping that we're all back here together for real next year.